Okay, so we're from Team Rocket, and there's a bunch of other people here also from Team Rocket. And maybe you were on the camp and you also already know much of the Rocket. But for all of those who weren't at the camp, here's a short introduction at what the Rocket is, and what is going on here on Congress. Motivation. So, maybe some of you were already on US events like the HOPE or DEF CON, and they already have a long tradition of electronic name or badges. Not necessarily name badges, but badges. And we found, well, that's rather cool. We'd like to do that ourselves too. Well, we'd like to do it a little bit different. Not these coin cells, which are always empty, and small displays, which you can't see very much, and special microcontrollers, which you have to program under Windows with evaluation tools, limited in size and everything else. We wanted something free, with a free controller, with a rechargeable battery, and a big display. So, this was actually our first batch. It's from the Munich. It's from Munich event, a rather small event. We did 300 batches, hand soldered with, let's say, about 5 components, and we sold 100 kits, which could be populated by the participants of the event. They sold out in minutes, and it was a rather huge success for us. We didn't expect that it would run so well. So, we decided let's take it to the next level. Let's do a batch for a CCC event, a big event. And the camp offered us the possibility to do this in terms of money. It was possible to squeeze the Rocket into the camp ticket, and together with lots of sponsoring, we were able to push the price below 15 euros, just below. So we added a nice, cheap, Chinese-made Nokia display, actually for $1 each. We searched for custom ones and very, very expensive. We put a battery on it, rechargeable, a recharging controller so you can't accidentally overcharge the battery. We put on that pointer is useless now. We put on a RF interface, a rather cheap one, the same used in the OpenBeacon tags, a ARM7, or no, a Cortex-M3 microcontroller, which was sponsored by NXP. They gave it to us for free. And we added some extension headers so you could develop your own extensions for Rocket and let it serve you as a development board for your own hardware. So it was, let's say, rather a success at camp, and lots of people asked us about a new production run of rockets, and we thought about it, and we thought about it rather a long time, and it was a question, where can we actually produce new rockets? Our old manufacturer was it's a one-off. It was a one-off. He sponsored us the production, the assembly, the soldering, and made us a very good price, but actually the company is not in business doing this. So how much are we going to cost was the next question. We had lots of sponsored parts and sponsored services and did a lot of things ourselves. We soldered 6,000 pin headers and resoldered 3,000 USB sockets and everything, and that's not possible anymore. People are getting tired of doing this, and we had to do a full assembly, and the assembler had to do everything. So how many to produce? Well, we had 3,000 rockets at camp, and now there's going to be about 3,000 participants here. So who's actually going to buy one? Oh, that's not actually a question to you, but thanks. We thought, well, maybe 1,000. That's a rather optimistic guess, we thought, and we started to look around, what would that cost? And who would pay? I mean, you have to give the money to a manufacturer and you get the things and then you get the money back from the people. And actually, 1,000 pieces at 15 to 30 euros, that's a lot of money and nothing we can personally actually lend to the project. So we looked around and Mitch Altman gave us a recommendation, Etonet in China. He's using their services to do the TV Begun, I think. And he gave us the contact there, and well, the contact said, well, okay, let's do 1,000 pieces, but you have to tell us the price. And he say if it's okay. Okay. Well, so we gave them a value, a number, and they said, okay, we can do that for a little bit more. Well, okay. And actually, as we asked for 1,000, that's a third of the amount of the first run. Actually, the price is, let's say, rather okay, I'd say. So the 30 euros we are selling them here is not very much, there's no much margin in it. Actually, rather none. Yeah. So who's going to pay them? We asked the CCC, Veranstaltungsgesellschaft, it's a company of the CCC, and they said, okay, well, we don't believe that you're going to sell 1,000, let's do 300. And our manufacturer said, oh, why not do 500 at least? The minimum order quantities are so big. And we thought about it and we came to a solution. We asked Pollin. Pollin is a very special retail company here. They ship electronic goods, which are mostly surplus parts and are exotic parts and things which are left over from bankrupt companies and everything. And we asked them, would you sell our leftover rockets? And they said, yes. We always wanted an ARM development board. We're going to at least buy from you 300 and everything you have left over. But for every one of you who thinks, let's buy it at Pollin, not here, they are going to add a margin. And it's going to be way more than we are selling it right now. Let's say, I'd say we are going to sell about 50 euros. So prepare for that. Etonet is based in China and Shanghai, and Mitch also said to us, they have good working conditions. Actually, I'm going to China in April, and I'll visit them, and I'll have a look. But I believe Mitch in that regard, and so that was also, I think, a point worth notioning. They sourced for us all the parts. They exchanged that to parts made in China for some of them, which were better available in China. And actually, the time between the transfer of the money to us, or they sending the rockets away, was just 5 weeks. And they arrived really early, let's say, for this purpose for Congress in end of November, I think. That's nice, and actually, we were looking around for custom tariffs for rockets, and we found one, well, that's 3% customs and some 0% customs, and we sent a sample to German customs to evaluate it and tell us what is okay. Would it be 0% customs? And, well, the Chinese thought, let's just put on a customs number which says, PCB board with no active components, and especially no integrated circuits. Went through, no problem. So that's a rather nice thing. I'm not sure if they put that custom code on every single thing they ship to Europe. Maybe. So, and now our PCBs this time are actually yellow. The PCBs from the camp had some greenish tone, and they should have also been yellow. They were also made in China, but actually, it seems like Etonet has a better PCB manufacturer. We sent them a test firmware. They tested all rockets, made sure that that the hardware parts work, that the RF works, that the ADCs work, that the display connector and everything works. Turned out okay. So they also sent us an email, and it said, below 4 degrees Celsius, 15% of your rockets fail. Nice. Well, not really a concern for us, but it seems like they also tested it in a climate chamber. We didn't ask for that, but they did, and it's rather nice, I have to say. So, now, sex part begins.
Okay. Okay. About the rocket, one of the things we found important was extensibility. So we added what is called the module bus, which allows you to plug in custom modules, which has supports an I2C bus or SPI. That's these two nice black connectors at bottom. They support the flame module, which we sold at camp, which sold out quickly. We made new flame modules, actually enhanced flame modules with an RGB LED, which are sold here. The current firmware supports both of them. We invited everyone to do their own modules. We had a few people doing a few of these. We had like the Geiger counter at camp. Someone made a small Geiger counter. So I think we have another slide for that later on. One feature we did with the pin headers is they're designed in such a way that you can't turn the module by 180 degrees and it still works. So you don't have to, well, watch out which way you plug it in, and it still works. I think that's it. Moment. What? yeah, and actually, if you have stack through connectors, you can plug in multiple modules into each other, and it works. What you see in the picture, all of the flames will work. We have the hacker bus, which are the nice unpopulated holes at the right and left of the displays. That's also documented on the wiki. That's basically most of them are the leftover pins of the CPU, which we didn't use, which you can use for your own projects. In the new revision we sell here, we added two more pins, which are the pins used for the serial input-output, which the chip supports. They're also used for one of the LEDs, I think. So if you use the serial, the LED will maybe blink. We actually also managed, Schneider managed to fix the USB serial code. That's to say, there's also support for USB serial. And it actually works now and doesn't crash your rocket every 15 minutes. So it's not that important anymore, but it's, if you want to hack something, it's quite nice. We have support, which was actually quite a last minute addition for the camp, was the loadable module support. The firmware supports to load additional code from the data flash. It's like 2.5 kilobyte maximum size for the loadables. They can be loaded, and the functions, it can call functions from the main firmware if they are exported. That's realized by a jump table, which is at the beginning of the flash. There's some C define hackery, so you can just compile it and it will work. One important thing is every function you want to use needs to be exported, and you need to actually have a firmware flashed which exports this. So if you have an old firmware and use new loadables, it will break. But if you use an old loadable with a new firmware, that will still work. There's some problems with the loadable support. One of the things is if you want to write one yourself, actually the first function in your C file will get executed. The examples, the function is called RAM, but actually it's unimportant. The name is unimportant. It just jumps to the first byte of the loadable. And so the first function in your C file will execute it. Several people got bitten by this. If you have a support function and put it at top because you don't want to predefine it, you will have a hard time debugging it. And the second problem is if you have global variables and initialize them, that won't actually work. I have an idea why this is, because we are doing some evil linker tricks to actually get the loadable support working, and I think we're dropping the section with the initialized data values. So the current solution is just don't use static initialization, just initialize them in your function first if you want to have initialized values. That can take quite a time to debug also. I think that's all. We invite everyone to write loadables. We had quite a few people at camp writing loadables. Some of them have been added to the default Flash firmware. So you have quite a list of loadables on your rocket. It's under the execute menu. There's, for example, for the Geiger counter, which needs additional hardware, but we added most of them. There are more out there. We didn't have time to check all the submissions. We ran a bit out of time here. But we invite everyone to write new ones, and if you have a cool loadable module, send us an email and we might add it to the repository. Yeah, there was at the camp, the mesh worked, basically all the RF code worked encrypted, was encrypted because we didn't want people to mess with the stuff and wanted it to work. That relied on the CRP, this content read protection feature of the controller. It has different levels, and content read protection 2 disallows reading of the firmware. So you shouldn't be able to read the keys from the firmware. That was the idea. We had quite a few people at camp trying to get around and find the keys. We had very nice exploits using the font renderer, for example, which had a buffer overflow, and when a few people were actually printing parts of the Flash as a font on the display and then counting pixels to get the values back. I rather like that. There were social engineering attacks also, which worked given... Yeah, not too surprising. But the most important stuff, which we haven't really talked much about, is that also the content read protection was actually broken at camp. We had some nice hacker reading the firmware back and just getting the keys this way. We, as NXP sponsored the CPUs for us, we actually called them the next day and said, hey, looks like your chip has this little problem there. There were I never found out if they were amused or not amused, but I don't think so. We were a little bit quiet about it because we didn't hear much back from NXP. NXP actually has released or is releasing during this Congress a press release about this. They have produced some kind of software fix, which I haven't seen, and notified all the customers which use the chips in larger quantities. And they have produced a hardware fix, which goes into production in January. It takes quite some time to get it to the actual silicon. And it will be fixed, chips produced in January, and later will have this problem fixed. One other workaround is to use the even harder content read protection level 3, which locks the chip down even more. This one was not broken, but it's rather inconvenient to work with it. Okay. Yeah, because there was basically no point in trying to keep the key secret, we went for the open approach, and their current firmware has absolutely no encryption anymore. I did some changes to the mesh code and disallow most of the packets, because as there was absolutely no encryption, I was sure that everyone would try to broadcast their own packets, and I didn't want to have 15 entries in the mesh table all saying, hey, I'm cool, I broadcasted my own packets. So it only supports the current time, and which currently doesn't work, the next starting talk in each room. That's because I didn't have the time to set up the laptop for that. The new firmware also has basic support for a color LCD. There is a Nokia LCD which supports color, which has the same connector. We are, I think we have still a few left to sell. The current firmware supports the display in a way that you can plug it in and turn it on and it still displays things. It doesn't actually do much color because we have space constraints on the in the flash and weren't able to squeeze color in there. There are loadables which display color images. The current, it's not on the default flash, but talk to Ray afterwards. He knows where in Git you can get the correct code. The firmware also supports the RGB flame. I already told you that, and we have lots of new loadables. One new loadable we have is, well, it's not that new, it's the Rockets, which has a small graphics lib added to the firmware, and if you turn it on the first time, the new Rockets, you will see the small rocket ship flying and landing. That's actually a small graphics lib which was graciously donated by, I think it's some GIMP developer. I forgot the name, I'm sorry. That's quite nice. All the functions are exported for loadables to use. There's a Farplan app which you can browse through the entire Farplan, which talks are when. It relies on a file, some binary blob containing all the talks. So that needs to be semi up to date to actually have the correct information. But it should be on the rockets you buy, should be a current version. And there's a new loadable R player, which is the remote player, which uses the RF chip to support playing games remotely. There's down at the Hack Center, some people managed to have a four-player Tetris on an LED display. You can play in four people. I don't know if it's working already. I had some problems, but it was nearly ready. We have a simple Pong version where two players can play Pong against each other. We will still have to set it up, but we can show you downstairs later. And if you have time, we will try a mass Pong with all the people who have a rocket in here. We have some new single-player games on the rocket and some other new modules like the People's module, which lists the nicknames of people around you as long as they have privacy off, so tracking enabled. Okay. Yeah.
So we are trying to set up an open beacon tracking here at the Congress. We already put up the readers, like the one above there. We're waiting for the NOC to patch it for us, and we hope tonight we get the tracking available. It will be a public JSON API available with the tracking results of every single batch which has tracking enabled, so everyone can access it. It's publicly available. Milos from the Open Beacon team donated or lent us its readers, which is very generous from him. Well, let's hope we get it working, and the People Nearby app uses also the Open Beacon packets which are sent, and we added a feature that New rockets will also send their nickname if they have privacy to zero, or which equals trackable. And we're trying to put the nicknames also into the JSON. So there's no central registration form for this tracking. Your rockets will just broadcast your nickname, and we are trying to put it into the JSON. So we are working hard on it, and I guess tonight it will be available.
I actually found out we're running out of time. So I will be very quick about the rest. There's a Python library to support the remote gaming feature. There's an application for the rocket. You can flash on it to announce that you have a game, so the remote player can list it. If it supports sending the button movement and the nick and displaying a text back to the player. We have some rocket launchers graciously donated by Get Digital. If you want to do some cool hack with one of these USB rocket launchers and the rocket, stop by at our desk. You can get one. We will have you will have to give us some money, so we are sure you bring it back. You'll get your money back if you bring it back, or if you do a cool hack, you will get to keep the rocket launcher and get your money back. So. You can bring it back in any condition. So if you have to open it, it's not really a problem. Some modules which were designed. There's a laser tag module which will be sold. I think someone is he here? Oh, back there. He built modules for a laser tag game and will sell them. And I think we'll try to use them. There's the RGB flames which will be sold, and there's some obscure network module. I don't know anything about it. Nobody knows. The most interesting announcement is the rocket shop will open at I think 7 p.m. today when at the info desk or near the info desk again. If you want to buy something, these are all the URLs. We encourage you all to participate. We will do announcements on Twitter as the JSON becomes available or the shop opens. And I think we're completely out of time, are we, Tui? No? Okay, then we can try to do the Pong stuff.
Yeah. You try to set it up. Then I the VGA. So, no question answer yet, but Zach told you about the player loadable, and we have an option for it. So your rocket sends the position of your joystick, and our idea is now we divide the whole room into two groups, left and right, and we prepared a Pong game running in JavaScript in a web browser, and we have set up two OpenBeacon readers from Milos. So who of you has a new rocket? Oh, all right, okay. So all of you should have the R player loadable. And if you start it, you will see two games, left and right. And if you select it, you can your rocket will say now playing left or now playing right. We distributed three rockets here in this room which are announcing that game, and hopefully you will be able to play Pong. And the idea is the two sides, every packet, you send packets in a regular basis, and SEX software is, playing magic to it and transferring it into a paddle position on the Pong game field. I'm not sure. I think he takes the average of your button movement. So if your side suddenly has the idea, oh, the paddle should go down, and all of you press down, the paddle will be instantly down. So So you have to decide on a more or less, let's say, random basis how much you want to press down now. I think they are still busy with setting up their VGA port. Okay, yeah. Well, good. In the meantime, Q&A.
Your left or our left?
I'm sorry?
Which side is left for me?
Oh, all right. No. It's seen from you. If you, so this is the right-hand side and this is the left-hand side. All right. Yeah, we did this. We're doing this all the time. And who of you sees the games? Oh, nice. So we have a good coverage, it seems. And who of you already has joined a game? Have you joined the right side? So, yeah, well, you can't choose any side, but you should choose the side you're on. We hope that most of you choose the right side, and the few people who think they can hack this contest, on this game, won't have much of an influence on the actual outcome. So, now a question. Someone have a question? What? Yeah, we are just trying to put...
Oh. Could you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, he asked if he could, if you're going to display the game on screen, and yes, we are. Soon.
Working on it. Anyone else have any questions? Because I'll go around the room and give you the microphone, or rather hold the microphone for you.
Yeah, just to make sure I got this correctly, there's still rockets available, and when can I buy one?
All right. Well, the thing is, we have to share the desk at which we sell them with some official CCC business, and then they have opened. We can't sell rockets, and we also have to spare the people to sell them, but I think at... 19 o'clock today, it will be the sale open. Yes.
It's the big queue next to the info desk. There's always lots of people wanting to buy rockets. It was the same yesterday.
We had no idea that that something like yesterday would happen. We thought, well, we're going to sell on day zero, so we can stretch it out a little bit and don't have the big queues during... the day 1 to 4, and we thought it would be a... Oh, all right, okay, it seems something is working, actually. So just to test, the right side put down, everyone. Oh, no, oh you're playing already. Oh, okay. No. Oh! What you don't know, we are faking all of this. It's just a computer game. You have no influence. No. Oh.
The numbers at the bottom are the amount of players registered on each side.
So in theory, the side with more players should have the advantage, as if you would be only one player, you had three positions, middle, full up, and full down. So, what? Yay! Just steady. Oh. Oh, I remember, we thought about increasing the pedal size. Did we increase the pedal size?
What?
Did we increase the pedal size? Oh, okay. So, who's leading? Oh, 3-3. Oh.
Right side is winning.
They give up any other
To be actually at the top, everyone needs to be at top. If even three people don't, every person who doesn't push up will keep you from reaching the top. We plan to reserve a small slot on one of the lightning talks to do this once again. If you want to, I don't know how much time we have left. How much time do we have?
It's about 15 minutes.
What? 15? Okay, no. So go ahead, play. I thought we were running out of time. If anyone has a question in the meantime?
There is one question on the IRC.
Yeah, jointly from the IRC is asking, is there any estimate when they will be sellable on the internet, even if there are no leftovers, probably?
We will, after the Congress, when we had time to go back and sleep a few days, we will pack up all the rest of the rockets and send them to Poland. We don't actually know how long it will take to show up in the shop then, but I'd suspect like a month, maybe.
Yeah, Poland is going to repackage them, and I think they want to print a manual for it and everything. We already sent them some. I'm not sure how far they are, but one thing. There are going to be rockets available at Pollen. We had to make a deal. So we had to make a deal that Pollen needs at least 300. So we have 700 rockets here available, and 300 are definitely going to Pollen. Else we would probably have no rockets at all here. So yeah.
Are there any more questions in the audience? Please raise your hand. I can't see you when you're talking like this with a small voice. Okay. Questions? Anyone? Yeah, over here.
The sale, we have updated information on the sale. It will start on 19:30 hours.
So I have I have a question to the game I'm playing currently. So that I understand it right, the transmission is now done through the mesh network. So what is the latency of the messages when I'm in the back?
No, it's actually not done through the mesh network. The game transmission is actually done direct. We have two nice readers here, one for the right players and one for the left players, and that's going directly. So beyond this room, you won't be able to participate.
Okay. Any more questions, or are you all busy playing?
Yes. One thing I want to say about the mesh network. I actually found a rather embarrassing bug in the release version 4 firmware for the Congress. It actually, we didn't check the CRC checksum. that happened when we disabled the encryption. The CRC was actually checked after the decryption, and when we disabled it, we didn't even check the CRC, which means that the all up to R4 are very, very buggy mesh network, because single bit errors will not be detected, and then your time and text will be broken. You can flash the new version, the R5, it's on the wiki, and we have a flash station downstairs where it's sitting, where you can flash your rocket with the current firmware.
We have a question here in the front row.
Was Etonet the only producer you asked, or did you have some alternatives you asked for an offer?
No, actually not. Yes, it was the only producer in China. We asked some in Germany for the production at the camp, but they were way too expensive for us. And actually, by the time we decided we're going to do this, we don't really had time to look around much. We had to say, let's do it with him, let's do it with our contact at Etonet, and he gave us a lot of support. I think he wanted to land this contract to have an amplification, but it was a rather nice experience, yes.
We have two more questions on the IRC channel. First question.
Yeah, FWG is asking what the Pong score is.
Okay, let's see. Left side 9, right side 12. So, seems like the right side with fewer players is winning, but just by a little bit. 32 players on the left side, 25 players on the right side currently.
And the second question on the channel?
And Jointy again is asking if that software for this game is already on Git.
The source code.
The JavaScript Pong implementation is in Git. I've made some small last-minute changes, which I'm going to commit after the talk. The Python script collecting the reader information is currently not in a workable state in Git. I plan to commit it later. There are two versions of the script, one which works with the hardware readers, and there's another version which uses a rocket as receiver, which will be more accessible to the rest of you. There in the tools, game, subdirectories, all the stuff.
Yeah, we mostly hacked that together an hour ago, so for that I have to say it's working quite nice.
Any more questions in the room? Please raise your hand.
Yeah, at the front row.
Well, how difficult would you say it is to rebuild the rocket? Maybe not in the same shape, but just like taking the parts, finding the parts, building something similar. Impossible, difficult, easy, no problem at all.
You mean for the John Doe, for someone? Well, it's just a two-layer board, so that's not really a problem. You can order it for cheap everywhere. But the RF chip is a leadless chip. You have to solder it at least with a hot air gun. Better reflow, but it's possible with hot air. We soldered our prototypes with a hot air gun. Yeah, and schematics and PCB layouts, rare Eagle schematics and Eagle layouts are all available in our Git repository. And they're licensed under some Creative Commons license, I think. Should be no problem. But if you're doing it again, I'd advise you to have a look at the power distribution system. It's not the best. Yeah, it's working, but could be improved.
Anyone else? Any more questions? Anyone? Still busy playing. There's not so many people playing now. Is
no.
There?
Still some.
I was wondering how I would come across a color display. Here?
Ray is selling them at the Team Rocket help desk. It's the Team Rocket help desk down in the Hack Center at in the hardware hacking area. And we are in the back right corner. I'm not sure if there are still some left.
We don't have very much of the color displays. I think we have like 30 or so left. So basically, if you want to do something here at Congress with a color display, come down and get one. But the reason why we didn't bring so many is they're very easy to get. You can get them on eBay, or some Chinese sellers are selling them with 2 weeks shipping, and it doesn't cost more than we sell here. So if you just want to have it for your home, just order it after Congress if we run out of them, so it's no problem. But feel free to come down and buy one if you want to do something here or want one. But so it's not that bad if you don't get one.
And if you want one here, be quick. We get another question on IRC.
Yeah, Polter is asking if the tracking is legal in EU and Switzerland, and he'd like to use these rockets in a public event, whatever that means.
I'm not sure why it should be illegal. If you turn it on for the first time, it asks you if you want to be tracked or not. There are three settings, which is like one is full tracking, and the second one is enables only the mesh, so it doesn't allow tracking, but the RF chip is still in use. And the third setting completely disables the RF functionality of the firmware, so if you don't want to be tracked, turn it off. The setting is available in the config menu at any time. The other thing is the chip is using the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum. We moved the channels all out of the way of all the wavelan here in use here. It's in the area reserved for educational and personal use on ISM band. So if you want to do it commercially, I don't think you're allowed to use it as for commercial applications, but we are not doing that. But you could always change the channel downwards to someone where the wavelan is, and then you could do other stuff.
We have a very few minutes left, so last minute questions. Over here in the middle.
Thank you. I'm a teacher, and at my school we have some smart boards, rather active boards, and I think this system is a very cheap way for interactive use for the students for such boards. Is there somebody who builds something connections for the rocket?
I'm not sure I understood it correctly. Sorry. Can you
maybe could you repeat it, rephrase your question?
At my school, we have smart boards, active boards.
Okay.
And it's... No? Okay.
Okay.
So the interactive whiteboards are a projector onto a whiteboard.
Ah, okay, yes,
you
yeah.
You can draw with
I get you.
Active pens, and it displays it through the projector.
Okay. And what are you planning to do with the smart board?
When I use the interactive board, yeah. The students cannot anything interactive. Only yeah. One at the wall acts.
Yeah.
And so I think such rockets are a possibility that all the students can do something.
Yes.
By using this communication. You can buy very expensive pets for the students, but there's no chance to get the money.
Do you know the IMME? It's a American, in America it's available some kind of mini instant messenger with works in the vicinity, and it has a small keypad and a small display, and it comes in a rugged case with batteries and everything in it, so it can be thrown into a bag or something. Maybe that's more of a thing you're looking for. I think Travis Goodspeed has hacked them to death. Everything. He does everything with these things. So, the IMME. IMME. Yeah, instant message me, yeah.
Is there one more super last minute question? One more question, maybe? No, people are already leaving, hey.
Okay.
Okay, then.
Have a nice camp.
Thank you very much. Please give it up for the speakers.